Recent terror attacks in Europe, including the attack last Saturday by three men in a van who plowed into pedestrians on London Bridge, are renewing the debate over extremists and their use of social media. The British Prime Minister, Theresa May, accused tech companies like Facebook and Twitter of not doing enough to stop ISIS recruitment efforts in cyberspace. Elizabeth Bodine-Baron is an expert on social media and terror, the nonpartisan RAND Corporation, and she joins us from Los Angeles. It's nice to see you. I've heard, because I sit on the board of RAND, presentations around this issue. Why don't you spell out for everybody how terrorists and would-be terrorists use social media?
Thank you for having me. So the main use of social media by terrorists is both for propaganda and for recruiting. So they'll use some of the more public forums to spread their message, whether it's a message of violence or the more positive side, the message of belonging and following true Islam within their caliphate. With the recruiting side, it tends to start out with someone following propaganda, and then it will move to a more secure channel, such as encrypted communications via Telegram, Signal, WhatsApp, in order to do more operational details.
So it begins that way. Is there any way realistically to think that you could shut down those communications, but at the same time have an open internet and have other people who are not would-be terrorists use social media?
So that's a great question. And there's definitely a tension there between the free and open use of the internet and the desire to remove some of this more extremist content. And a lot of the tech companies, Twitter in particular, have done a really good job in terms of suspending a lot of these accounts. It's somewhat of a whack-a-mole problem because as soon as they suspend one, then they'll pop right back up. But there has been evidence showing that since they began their campaign in March 2015, that there has been a decrease in the number of ISIS supporters actively using the platform. And when they do pop back up, there's a decrease in their ability to retain those followers.
Theresa May, as I mentioned in your introduction, has been very angry at the big tech companies like Twitter, like Facebook. She says they're not going far enough. What could the big tech companies be doing that they're not doing right now?
So they're already actively pursuing removal of a lot of this content. And Facebook in particular is pursuing a second part of the strategy, which is providing an alternative method, an alternative message, where they are promoting positive messages that say why you shouldn't engage in violent extremism and supporting those who are already putting that message out there. So our research found that despite this perception that ISIS might be winning the war on social media, there's actually a huge number of ISIS opponents already active on platforms like Twitter. In fact, the ratio we initially found was 6-1, and since the suspension campaign began, that ratio has only increased. And so the goal for these companies should be, how can they better support these already active opponents to violent extremists? Can they provide them additional training? Could they provide them what we call shareable content or access to things that they might not otherwise have to bolster their message that they're already trying to spread?
Is it more than just the big tech companies? Is propaganda and recruiting happening in ways that are leveraging the smaller tech companies, that they just don't happen to be the focus of some of the anger that follows in the wake of these terror attacks?
It's entirely possible. Most of our research has focused exclusively on Twitter, but judging the way that ISIS has been very sophisticated in using a lot of these different platforms, I would not be surprised that some of the more smaller companies could also be pursuing some of these methods.
I was just going to say that's the second time I've heard you use the word sophisticated, and you've also said sophisticated and motivated. What do you mean by that? I guess I feel that, you know, some of the propaganda seems not so sophisticated and sort of a little crude and rough.
So in fact, a lot of the videos that they put together, by judging from prior standards, are incredibly slick and well produced. A lot of the people that they have using social media and tweeting are essentially millennials. They are young people who are disaffected with their current lives and go and join this caliphate and promote a message of, oh, everything is great here. I mean, they'll even spread, you know, cat videos. So they're really active in terms of using a lot lot of the memes that are already out there, and they're a natural audience. They naturally connect with others of their own age. And so when I say sophisticated and committed, what I really mean is that not only are there central media centers that create specific propaganda, they also have this body of followers and distributors that operate creating some of their own content, but also disseminating some of that officially endorsed content.
What could be a big solution that's somewhere between not just how do we send out alternative messages, but doesn't go as far as saying, well, let's just shut down the internet. That'll certainly solve, you know, the social media issues. What could be done that's more aggressive?
So one interesting development has been what's called the Google redirect method. So when someone goes onto Google and searches ISIS beheading video, what they'll get instead is a bunch of YouTube hits from people within the community explaining why violent extremism is not in line with the teachings of Islam. And so when they are flagged as searching for these things, instead they'll be redirected to something that's a more positive message, something that will possibly get them to think, oh, well, here's a different way that I could pursue and fulfill this need that I have of belonging, which is really one of the fundamental messages. And then there's also a lot to do with both promoting these alternative methods and then messages, and then also addressing some of the underlying issues.
Are you hopeful that there is a strategy that could actually mitigate what we have seen as terrorists and potential terrorists leveraging social media online?
I think things are moving in the right direction. A lot of the technologies that these companies have been developing have gotten more and more sophisticated with the advances of research in looking at big data and pattern analysis and lexical analysis, being able to quickly target certain key themes and understand and then create a message to counter that is really important. And there's also been efforts both from the U.S. government and other governments in terms of partnering with each other to support NGOs and individuals within communities who are already trying to combat this violent message, and giving them either financial support, access to content, training, whether it's how to do better social media work or better active in-person work, because it's not all just about the online message. It's also about what happens offline, which in many cases is actually a more important factor for someone becoming radicalized.
Yeah, I was going to say the online is often the beginning and the offline is where it sort of heads. Elizabeth Bodine-Baron, thank you so much. Appreciate it.
Thank you.